Hi everyone and welcome back to NBA Hangouts with the NBA Academy powered by ACG. I'm Karan Singh and I'm here to cover those moments that made the 2019-20 finals and off-season better with my friends from the NBA Academy, Achintya Krishna and Pritish Kokate, along with our resident expert Akshay Manwani. Also joining us today are two super fans of the game. We have Karan Singh, an avid basketball player and a huge Lakers fan. He's also the managing director of ACG, the official partner of the NBA Academy and its initiatives like the ACG NBA Jump Program. Also joining us today is Yohan, the managing director at Chirag Din and a huge Pat Riley fan.
Lay it up and in. Look at ball handle, a ball down the lane and throw it down. How about that for the big man? Emphatic finish. And he knocks it down.
I'll start with you, Yohan and Karan. Your reactions to Lakers taking on the Miami Heat, that game six where they finally got the coveted 17th championship. What is that feeling like? What was your reaction? Who were you rooting for in that epic duel?
Well, I would say the Lakers are a very deserving champion. They were the best team in throughout the bubble. The Heat were overmatched. There's no doubt about that. It took every ounce of power from them, that Heat culture coming down from Pat Riley all the way down and like Jimmy Butler like doing as much as he could. But eventually, I think they just ran out of gas and they just couldn't match up with the Lakers. LeBron and AD, of course, were just too much. So,
Karan, I'm going to jump to you. Your reactions on the NBA final. How was it watching LeBron take away another ring?
You know, I've seen LeBron live in the finals and I've seen LeBron, you know, during these finals and the previous finals, when that guy smells blood in the water, he goes for it. You know, when that game was coming up, I pretty much knew this is the closeout game and LeBron's going to take it on himself. And you saw him in the first quarter itself. He ended the game with a triple-double. And, you know, that's done in typical LeBron style. So whether anyone else showed up or didn't show up, LeBron was going to show up. He was going to carry the team on his back. And that's exactly what he did.
LeBron restored the legacy of the Lakers with their 17th championship, this one coming after a decade. But there has been so much movement in the offseason, especially this being the shortest offseason in the history of the NBA. We're going to jump to Akshay, our expert here. Akshay, tell us about all the big moves that have happened post the bubble and now back in the NBA with a new season.
The Los Angeles Lakers, you'll have to think back to a time, when was it that a defending champion actually upgraded to this extent? They got the, you know, reigning sixth man of the year. Marc Gasol was added to this team. Dennis Schroeder was acquired from the Oklahoma City Thunder. And then, you know, you had the move between Washington and the Houston Rockets. John Wall going to the Houston Rockets. Russell Westbrook coming to Washington Wizards. We believe that there were chemistry issues down there between Harden and Westbrook, former friends, former teammates. We also know that, you know, Chris Paul is now headed down as a veteran kind of figure on the Phoenix Suns team. The big news for Milwaukee was that Giannis decided to re-sign, which is great news for the small market teams in this league because they find it very difficult to hold on to superstars. And besides that, their acquisition of Drew Holiday, who I personally think is a good upgrade over Eric Bledsoe, can play both ways, can create his own shot, is a terrific wing defender. There's an upgrade that's happened in Milwaukee. I think they'll also, along with the Lakers, be happy with you know, what's happened in the offseason. But keep your eyes tuned in to what's happening in Houston.
Achintya, how are you feeling about this offseason? And what do you think, which are the teams that are actually much stronger in the West and the East now?
I think a lot of teams made good moves this offseason. I think one which made the best move was the Atlanta Hawks. They signed Danilo Gallinari. They got Bogdanovic. Now they have Capella, Trae Young, and they have a pretty good young team with also veterans filled in. I think they're going to make the playoffs this year. And also another team that was interesting was Philly. Philly got rid of Hal Horford's huge contract.
Also got Doc Rivers, man, as the head coach.
Yeah. And it was so immediate. Doc Rivers got fired from the Clippers and immediately next day, Philly hired Doc.
Pritish, what are you looking at when you look at the new season? What are the teams that you feel have become stronger in the East and the West?
By like young core, I would say the Atlanta Hawks have improved a lot because at first it was only Trae Young and John Collins. these two youngsters were just playing through the league. But now they have added Capella, because these teams like Suns and Hawks, they have gotten two good veterans who can mentor their younger players, like CP3 for Devin Booker and also Rondo for Trae Young. These young teams, I would say, have been improved a lot. So I would say this season is very interesting. And with the season being short, the teams are going to have to adapt to the situations that they face.
Yohan, your thoughts on how the new teams are shaping up? Who are you most excited to watch? Which are the players in the teams that you feel have become stronger?
Well, I definitely think Chris Paul will improve the Suns. I don't think they're going to make the finals or anything like that. But he will make them grow up a little faster than they would have otherwise. But the team that I really like in the East is the Philadelphia 76ers. They've got the right pieces around Joel and Ben Simmons. Tobias Harris can now play more power forward since Al Horford's gone. But I've always hoped that Philly does well. I'm a fan of big men, so I've always kind of rooted for Joel Embiid, and like, it's always been slightly disappointing the way their seasons have ended. So let's hope we always have 2021 going forward. Let's hope it goes well for them.
Karan, your thoughts on the East? Who's become stronger? Your thoughts on the West? Is it still a battle for LA?
Let's start with the East. Certainly Philly's, as Yohan mentions, had a massive upgrade. I think they will do well. I think Boston's going to get much, much stronger this year. They've also got a really young roster, you know, with Jason Tatum and the whole bunch of guys there. I think with Kemba and others, I think they're going to upgrade this year. And I think they're slated for the NBA Finals. Obviously, the Brooklyn Nets, you can't forget them. I love KD. I just don't know. I haven't seen enough of KD as yet to say how good he is. Is he back to pre-injury stage? Is that going to take another 6-8 months? I like the Brooklyn Nets. I like the way they're made up. Milwaukee's going to be up there with the additions that they've made to their roster. And I think Brooklyn Nets. I think those are my four teams in the East. On the West, obviously the Lakers are top. I hope Golden State makes a comeback. But with Thompson's injury, I don't know. You know, it's going to be really, really tough. But the Clippers are going to be up there. Houston's obviously in disarray. So I don't expect them to do much. Dallas will be up there. I think they had a good run. Denver's going to be up there again, just like last year. But I don't see them making the NBA Finals. I see them making it to the second round, maybe conference finals, but not the NBA Finals.
Karan, I have another question for you. What was the motivation behind bringing in ACG and NBA together?
So, Harman, I mean, I don't know if you know too much about the ACG NBA Jump program, but we started that like 3 years before the Academy started. And there, the whole plan was to go across India and recruit talent. We had about 5,000 to 10,000 kids across the country that attended the programs, attended the workshops, from which we actually picked one player, the best of the lot, that we felt the best of the lot. We sent him to the G League. And what we realized is that there was so much talent to pick from and choose from that it became so difficult. And what we also realized is there was no ecosystem or platform for this, you know, these young, talented guys to actually get further training and continue to pursue their passion of playing basketball. And that's really what gave the emergence, sort of the thought behind the NBA Academy.
What you've done personally, I think it's one of the best things that a young aspiring sportsman can get, is a safe environment where they can study well, they can play hard, they've got nutrition sorted, and there's somebody who's looking out for them, and it's you guys. Thank you so much, man.
Arman, listen, I lived in India. I played basketball in India. I always had a dream to play for the NBA. But, you know, in India, the problem was we never had any formal training. We never had any formal coaching. There was no real platform. There was, you know, there wasn't even real facilities.
We used to play on a cement court, which had holes in it.
Same. We've all done the same.
We will have an NBA player from India.
Yeah. Hell yeah. Guys, 71 days after the bubble ended, we're back in action. Yohan, your thoughts on the games. What was it like to see them back in action so quickly? I mean, these teams have got some kind of rest, but the Lakers, they were just doing this a few days back.
So first of all, it's wonderful to have the NBA back. Some great action. The Warriors, I don't have much hope for. They don't have enough outside shooting, unfortunately. Steph's a bit fragile. Like, we don't know if he's going to get injured. But of course, the main event was the Lakers and the Clippers. And one regular season game doesn't mean anything. So what happened yesterday is meaningless. They won opening night a year ago as well, which, you know, we know how that ended up. But it's going to be exciting.
Karan, yesterday I heard a very funny joke. It said the Clippers are back-to-back reigning champions of opening day basketball.
I think the Lakers have really strengthened their roster with Dennis Schroeder and a couple of the other young guys that they brought. I mean, it's younger-ish guys that they brought on board. I think the Clippers, while they did really well, I think Kawhi needs to step up as a greater leader.
We're going to quickly ask you guys your make it better moments. I'm going to start with you, Yohan.
So my make it better moment was Giannis re-signing with the Bucks. I really think that's huge for the NBA. We cannot have a league that just has five good teams and all the talent just flocks to those five teams. It's really uplifting for the rest of the small market teams, especially Milwaukee, obviously. Whether they win a championship from it or not, at least they have one of the marquee players, one of the two or three super duper stars that there are in the league today. You know, at least a small market team managed to retain them. So let's hope that's a sign of things to come and an end of the era of super teams. Like, let teams build organically, let them grow together, and then let them win or lose together. So they really feel that passion amongst each other.
Karan, your make it better moment.
I have two make it better moments. I think one is from a fan's perspective, just seeing the fans back in the stadium, seeing the hoopla around the game, seeing the mascots running around, seeing the dancers on the floor. I mean, for me, that's one big make it better moment. I think it makes the game that much more special. As far as the game goes, for me, the make it better moment will be watching that next superstar, you know, establishing himself on the NBA stage. So whether it's Zion or whether it's someone else, one of these young guys, for me, that make it better moment would be watching that next guy sort of step in. Who's going to fill in those shoes of LeBron? Who's going to fill in the shoes of Michael Jordan? I don't know. You know, it's, for me, that's what I'm looking forward to.
It seems like LeBron thinks it's going to be Luka. We're willing to find out. Akshay, I'm going to jump to you. Your make it better moment.
Well, two moments. I'm also going to pick two moments. One is, as Yohan said, you know, Giannis's tweet, "This is my home. This is my city. I'm blessed to be able to be a part of the Milwaukee Bucks for the next 5 years. Let's make these years count." And my second moment, tying in with something that Karan said, is, you know, hats off to the league for being able to restart so quickly. It's just been 71 days since the Lakers raised their banner and played a game of basketball. I think there's a lot of thought that goes in, and those guys who work behind the scenes on scheduling and, you know, getting the science right, keeping the players safe, the coaching staff safe, hats off to them.
Pritesh?
I also have two moments. First one will be contract extending of Anthony Davis to Lakers, and he's here to stay, and he's obviously in the winning, kind of a franchise. And the second thing will be, you know, the younger teams like Charlotte and Atlanta, these, and Boston mainly, these teams, you know, come up and show up this year and, you know, being a great contender.
I'm going to quickly jump to you, Achintya. Your make it better moment.
My make it better moment for this season would be if Luka Doncic wins the MVP. I mean, I've been following this guy's since he's been
so your playing. Make it better moment is a futuristic hypothetical situation. Great.
Yeah. I've been following this guy since he's playing in the EuroLeague. He's my favorite player to watch, and yeah, I just hope he wins the MVP this season.
Thank you so much, guys. We'll see you soon. Thank you everyone for watching. Which moment according to you is going to make the new season better? Leave your favorite moment in the comments below.